We'll discuss about root canal irrigants. What are irrigants? Root canal irrigants are the solutions used to irrigate the canal while doing root canal cleaning and shaping procedure. So these are the solutions used to flush out the debris, bacterial products, dentinal chips out of the canal. So the reason behind the importance of using root canal irrigants is that pulp, being warm, moist, nutritious, it provides an environment which is rich in nutritious products from microbial growth, and also microorganisms in root canal avoids the defense mechanism of the host. They escape from the defensive mechanism of the host due to the lack of microcirculation in the dead pulp. There is no blood circulation in the dead pulp. So, host defense mechanism can't fight against the microorganisms in the dead pulpal space. So, the filing procedure during the BMP, biomechanical preparation or cleaning and shaping of the root canal, filing procedure provides a shape to the canal and it also eliminates this microbial load, but not completely. And in some narrow isthmus cases and some lateral canals, in some cases there will be lateral canal in the tooth, and in some cases C-shaped canals, and in some cases the isthmus will be too narrow. In those cases, the filing will not remove the complete microorganisms. So, in those cases, the irrigants, the importance of irrigation is very much useful. Irrigants are essentially provide cleaning procedure. They eliminate the microbial load. Filing procedure provides a proper shape, funnel shape to the canal to receive the gutta percha core. So this is the rational reason behind using irrigants and the objectives of irrigants. Objectives of using irrigants is to flush out, remove the dentinal chips, bacterial products from the root canal. That is the sole main objective of using irrigants, and they provide a lubrication for easy instrumentation with the filing cases. So, there are some ideal requirements of an irrigant. Irrigant must have antimicrobial property. First one, they must have antimicrobial property, and they must have tissue dissolving capacity so that any pulpal remnants, any remaining pulpal remnants can be eliminated by that tissue dissolving capacity. And they must be biocompatible, they must be non-toxic, they must not irritate the normal periradicular tissues, and they must provide lubrication, they must have low surface tension. The currently available irrigants, what we are commonly using, sodium hypochlorite, EDTA and chlorhexidine digluconate. The currently available irrigants doesn't meet all these ideal requirements. There are some lackings. So these are the ideal requirements. Essentially, they must have antimicrobial property, tissue dissolving capacity, and they must remove antimicrobial property. Second one is tissue dissolving property. And third one is lubrication. They must provide lubrication for easy instrumentation with the files. These are the ideal requirements what you need for a lubricants. Then coming to the factors affecting irrigation.
The factors affecting efficacy of the irrigations are, there are main four things. One is volume of the irrigant, volume, how much volume of the irrigant we are using, and second one is concentration of the irrigant, and third one is temperature of the irrigants, temperature of the irrigant, and fourth one is frequency of irrigation, frequency of irrigation. These are the four main important factors which determine the efficacy of the irrigants or irrigation procedure. Greater the volume of the irrigation, better will be the result. And concentration also, if the concentration is too high, the efficacy of the irrigant will be better. But if there is inadvertent extrusion into the periapical areas, then the harmful effects on the periradicular tissues will also be more. Then temperature, warm irrigants will provide better irrigating property. Then frequency, the more number of times you do the irrigation, better will be the result. After filing with every file, you should make sure that properly irrigate and flush out the dentinal chips and bacterial products. So these are the main four factors which affect the efficacy of irrigants. Then coming to the types of irrigants, there are commonly we are using three types of irrigants. They are sodium hypochlorite, EDTA, and chlorhexidine digluconate. Coming to the sodium hypochlorite, it is a reducing agent, clear straw colored fluid, and most commonly used irrigant among these three. This is the most commonly used irrigant. So the mechanism of action is, on ionization it produces hypochlorous acid, HOCl, hypochlorous acid and hypochlorite ion, OCl minus. So these are the two products which are responsible for the antimicrobial activity of the sodium hypochlorite, hypochlorous acid and hypochlorite ion. So these are the two ions which are responsible for the antimicrobial property of the sodium hypochlorite. They disrupt the DNA synthesis of the microorganisms. And the concentration used, we can use from a concentration of 0.5 to 5.2%. Sodium hypochlorite can be used in this concentration, 0.5 to 5.2%. But 5.2% is the most commonly used concentration of sodium hypochlorite. Then coming to the properties of sodium chloride, main property of the sodium hypochlorite is tissue dissolving capacity. That means pulp dissolving capacity, tissue dissolving capacity. In 20 minutes, it completely dissolves the pulp tissue. So, any pulpal remnants will be taken care of by this sodium hypochlorite solution. This is the sole and main advantage of the sodium hypochlorite. Then coming to the disadvantages of sodium hypochlorite. Disadvantages of sodium hypochlorite includes, it has unpleasant taste and smell also. Then it doesn't remove the smear layer. That is the most important disadvantage of the sodium hypochlorite. Main advantage is tissue dissolving capacity. Main disadvantage is unpleasant taste and doesn't remove the smear layer. And one more thing is sodium hypochlorite accident. That is unwanted extrusion of the sodium hypochlorite from the root apex into the normal periradicular tissues. Sodium hypochlorite accident.
okay, sodium hypochlorite accident. This is an important question which can be asked as a very short answer, and the sodium hypochlorite can be asked as a short answer 4 marks question, and the root canal irrigants completely can be asked as a 4 marks question. So sodium hypochlorite accident is the inadvertent, that is unwanted extrusion of the sodium hypochlorite from the root apex into the surrounding periradicular tissues. Okay, this is most common disadvantage. After sodium hypochlorite accident, the tissues, periradicular tissues will be inflamed, and the root canal's space will flood with the blood immediately. If there is unwanted extrusion into the periradicular tissues, the root canal space will flood with blood immediately, and the patient will complain of severe excruciating pain. Okay, so how can you manage this sodium hypochlorite accident? We must encourage the blood. We must encourage the bleeding. So bleeding is a physiological response to dilute the effects of sodium hypochlorite accident. Because sodium hypochlorite has caustic and deleterious effects on the surrounding periradicular healthy tissues. So we must encourage the bleeding, and we must assure the patient, and we must provide IV antibiotics and analgesics. If patient is not on the local anesthesia, then we have to give the block anesthesia. So patient should be on the anesthesia to decrease the pain. So this is all about sodium hypochlorite accident. So this is the sodium hypochlorite irrigant. Then coming to the EDTA, it is ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, EDTA. Okay, the mechanism of action is, it is a chelating agent. It chelates with the calcium ions of the dentin to produce the calcium chelates. So by producing that calcium chelates, it makes the dentin softer. It makes the dentin smooth and friable, so that we can easily instrument that dentin. So mechanism of action is based on formation of calcium chelates. This is the mechanism of action of EDTA. Then concentration of EDTA used is 17%. It is mainly indicated in cases of, we can routinely use this EDTA as an irrigating agent, but special indications includes calcified canals. So in these canals, irrigation with the EDTA, with the help of EDTA, we can achieve the canal patency in calcified canals, especially in old age patients. So this is the main indications of the EDTA. We can produce the canal patency, and it makes the dentin softer, so that we can instrument easily. Then coming to the properties. Properties means it removes smear layer. This is the main advantage of EDTA. It removes smear layer. This is the main advantage of EDTA. The disadvantages includes, it doesn't have the capacity of tissue dissolving effect. It doesn't have the capacity to dissolve the tissues. It have the capacity to remove the smear layer. That is the lack of tissue dissolving capacity. This is the main disadvantage of EDTA. Okay. So generally, what is the recommended regimen is that we have to first instrument with 17% EDTA for 1 minute, followed by the sodium hypochlorite irrigation. This is generally recommended irrigation regimen. First we have to irrigate with the EDTA, then have to followed by the sodium hypochlorite irrigation. This is all about EDTA. Then coming to the chlorhexidine,
chlorhexidine digluconate. Okay. The concentration of chlorhexidine digluconate used is 2%. 2% of the chlorhexidine digluconate is used. It has the main capacity of antimicrobial effect. It is used as irrigant due to its antimicrobial activity. It acts as bacteriostatic and bactericidal agent. Okay, and it, one more important property is it has action of substantivity. Substantivity, that means sustained release. Sustained release action. That means once you irrigate with chlorhexidine digluconate, the effect of irrigation, the effect of antimicrobial effect will be some more time. That means it will be active for 5 to 6 hours. It can have the antimicrobial activity for 5 to 6 hours. So this is the substantivity. It is mainly used as irrigant due to its antimicrobial activity. It has broad spectrum antimicrobial activity. It acts as bacteriostatic and bactericidal. And one more thing is, it is effective against Enterococcus faecalis. Enterococcus faecalis. It is effective against Enterococcus faecalis. This is the one of the main microorganisms found in failed root canal cases. Once the root canal treated case is failed, in those cases, Enterococcus faecalis is the main culprit. So, it is effective against the Enterococcus faecalis. Okay? It is used at a concentration of 2%. Coming to the properties, it doesn't have tissue dissolving capacity, it does not remove the smear layer. Only thing is, it has antimicrobial activity. It doesn't remove the smear layer, it doesn't have the capacity to dissolve the tissue. So these are the most commonly used irrigants: sodium hypochlorite, EDTA, and chlorhexidine digluconate. There are some normal saline, other irrigants used are other irrigants which can be used as root canal irrigants includes NaCl, that is normal saline, 0.9%. Okay, then we can use warm water can also be used as a root canal irrigant. And then we can use MTAD. This is one more important very short answer. Mixture of tetracycline isomer, citric acid and detergent. MTAD. Mixture of tetracycline isomer, citric acid and detergent. This can also be used as a root canal irrigant. Then coming to the irrigation guidelines. The first and foremost important thing is we must insert the needle into the root canal passively without binding with the root canal. It must not bind with the root canal. There must be sufficient space between the needle and the dentinal wall to flush out the dentinal debris or bacterial products out of the root canal. So this is the most important thing. That is passive insertion of the needle. Passive insertion of the needle. And second most important thing is no pressure on the plunger. If excessive pressure is applied on the plunger, the irrigant will escape from the root apex. So some sodium hypochlorite accidents like conditions will happen because of excessive pressure on the plunger. So there must not be any excessive pressure on the plunger. And the needle used is 30 gauze side vented and blunt ended. This type of needle should be used. This is specially endodontic needle, that is side vented and blunt ended, because assume that this is the canal. This is the canal. Okay, so this is the needle with side venting and blunt ending. This is the irrigation needle. So the irrigant will come out from this, okay, and it will flush out. There is no apical pressure. Okay, irrigation needle should be blunt ended and side vented. Blunt ended and side vented, so that there is no extrusion of the irrigant through the root canal apex, and there must be isolation with the rubber dam. Rubber dam isolation must be provided, so that any contact with the mucosal tissue is avoided. Because sodium hypochlorite on contacting with the mucosal tissues, it will produce ulcers. So these are the main irrigation guidelines which need to be followed. So the more the volume, concentration and the frequency of the irrigation, these are the main important factors which affect the efficacy of irrigation procedure. This is all about root canal irrigants.